This video follows on the introduction to hyperthyroidism in pregnancy. It is important to remember that both mother and fetus are affected by treatment. It is even more important to avoid hypo and hyperthyroidism in the fetus than in the mother. The drugs most commonly used are the thionamides. They include propylthiouracil, methimazole, and carbimazole. Carbimazole is metabolized to methimazole. Their side effects include a maternal rash, pruritus, hepatitis, lupus-like syndrome, drug fever, bronchospasm, and hypothyroidism. Another rare side effect is agranulocytosis, and a white cell count should be done on a regular basis in anyone on these drugs. Methimazole may have a slight risk of rare birth defects, but it's probably as safe as propylthiouracil, especially after the first trimester of organogenesis. There's controversy regarding which has greater transplacental movement and thereby putting the fetus at greater risk, with methimazole seeming slightly worse. Whichever drug is used, though, it must be assumed that it crosses the placenta. Thionamides are safe for use in breastfeeding, and it is recommended that they be taken directly after breastfeeding. It is important to continue taking the medication after delivery due to the risk of postpartum exacerbation of Graves' disease. The most important question is on dosage and the evaluation of adequacy of treatment. For various reasons, this is very difficult, as there is a poor correlation between dosage and the effect on the fetus. There are two reasons for this. Firstly, there are wide variances in drug absorption between women, and secondly, TSH receptor antibodies cross the placenta and may have inhibitory or stimulatory effect. It must be noted that most are stimulatory, though. In a publication in the New York Journal of Medicine in 1986, a group of researchers showed that maternal response to therapy is the safest method to overcome these problems. They showed that if the serum-free T4 of the mother is kept slightly elevated or within the upper third of normal, that 95% of neonates had normal free T4 cord blood levels. If maternal free T4 was in the lower two-thirds of normal, then 36% of neonates had lower than normal levels, and if the maternal free T4 was below normal, then 100% of neonates were hypothyroid. I discussed the effects of hypothyroidism on the fetus in the previous video series, and this condition must be avoided. The dosage of antithyroid drugs must thus be tailored to the effect on maternal free T4. The reference range for pregnancy should be about 1.5 times higher than for non-pregnant females, and treatment should aim to keep free T4 levels in the upper third of normal or even slightly elevated. Levels should be checked every 2 to 4 weeks and the decision on dosage of medication revisited. Managing the adrenergic symptoms directly is also problematic. There are not many studies out there, but beta blockers do seem to increase the risk of miscarriage, intrauterine growth retardation, fetal bradycardia, and neonatal hypoglycemia, and should generally be avoided. Alternate medical treatment of Graves' disease obviously includes the use of iodides. Neonatal hypothyroidism is a concern, but there are studies showing low-dose potassium iodide can be of use and is currently only recommended in those that cannot take thionamides or for those who are being prepared for surgery. Surgery is reserved only for uncontrollable cases requiring high doses of thionamides, such as more than 600 mg of propylthiouracil or more than 40 mg of methimazole per day for prolonged periods. It can also be offered to those that are non-compliant with medical therapy and to those with severe compressive symptoms. Surgery should be planned between weeks 13 and 24 and the patient prepared with a beta blocker and iodide for 14 days prior to surgery after full explanation of the risks involved in the medication and in the surgery. Propranolol is commenced at 20 to 40 mg per os every 6 to 8 hours. An intravenous esmolol can be used in an emergency. Radioablative therapy is not advised during pregnancy, as the fetal tissue is much more radiosensitive and it will lead to hypothyroidism. If a pregnant woman is inadvertently exposed to radioactive iodine, she should be given potassium iodide and a thionamide within 1 week. This combination blocks organification and reduces the radiation exposure to the fetus. Lastly, I must mention that the treatment of single or multinodule toxic disease should follow the same guidelines as for Graves' disease. In the next video, I will discuss the management of a thyroid storm during pregnancy.